All over the country, thousands of old buildings lie forgotten and neglected, often tangled up with red tape and development restrictions. Many of these properties are steeped in history and are of outstanding architectural interest. In this series, you're going to see buildings that no other sane developer would touch with a barge pole, windmills, follies, gatehouses, and churches. I'm passionate about our architectural heritage, and I want to help breathe new life into these buildings and make them useful again. Getting planning, though, can be really tricky.
I can't think of a good reason why this house should not have an extension.
You've got to understand the process, the politics.
The whole business has to be something you enjoy, and it's a way of life.
Luckily, up and down the country, people are buying these forgotten gems. These stubborn romantics all share one dream. They want to create a home which is totally unique.
I like the softened corners, the arches, the little tunnels.
I want this to be like a secret garden.
But their labours of love can come at a huge personal price, both financially...
We're not close to running out of money, we have run out of money.
...and emotionally.
It nearly tore us apart.
When you take on a listed building, you're taking on a responsibility.
You've got to listen to the people, you know. You can't just make exactly what you want.
I hope I can bring my vision and expertise to help these restoration warriors realise their dreams.
I just didn't want to live in a normal terrace house again.
A heritage house with all modern-day facilities, but crucially, with its structural soul intact. Celebrating the past, yes, but inventing a new future for these architectural treasures in the 21st century.
House.
You've decided that you're mad enough to turn a glorified commercial fridge into a house.
Yeah.
What are you doing?
Oh, this is defying gravity with concrete.
Have a look in there, look. Look at that. And that is basically hot molten rock.
You look like a bloody lunatic.
Oh, you should see how I feel.
This is what people need to know, is that if you're buying an old building before 1800, that it's going to have to get an archaeologist in.
But you thought you'd just ignore that and you'd just carry on and do some building work?
Of course.
Now, with the shadow of the archaeologists hanging over Gareth and Jill, I'm really conscious about the budget on this build. And it's easy to get carried away with design and with plans and with all your ambitions, but when the money's so tight, you've got to keep it well under control.
That's what makes this building special, man. You're creating a piece of history.
And all that hot sex we've been having.
I didn't know you knew about
no,
that.
No, not you.
It's yours, mate.
Oh.
Well done. You did it.
Some of my architectural heroes like Wren and later Georgian architects like Nash and Soane all built lavish stable blocks. More expensive, larger horses were imported into Britain to pull the coaches, as our ponies just weren't strong enough. And the British began to flash the cash, with fine stables becoming an essential feature of even the smallest country houses.
This building is so typically Sussex. Have you done anything like this before?
No.
So what are you thinking? Have you gone mad or something?
The footprint of the coach house is 1,900 square feet. It's a typical southeast English barn.
Has there been any points where you've been at your depth, though, where you've just thought, why the hell
just
are you doing this?
Maybe like for a day.
Whatever.
Sue phoned me up and she said, you've got to go and see this house. It's a really, really old building. Once you fall in love with it, that's it, isn't it?
Oh.
It's actually quite clever.
Yeah.
I shouldn't sound so surprised, should I?
No.
I don't see how it's going to turn into anything spectacular right now.
I can see now why you need the extension.
You may have to moderate slightly what your aspirations for your extension are, I'm afraid.
Can't destroy 500 years of history just because you bang your head on it.
Master Thatcher.
Yeah, that's the one.
Quite emotional, isn't it?
Oh, it is. Something. It is, yeah. When you actually bring history back, it just gives you such a satisfying pleasure. You just can't describe it.
So what makes you a 6-foot-something boxer, tough guy, buy a beautiful little building like this?
Something like 1,000 of the 5,000 country houses in the nation were knocked down at this time.
That's terrible, isn't it?
Shocked at that. That is just unbelievable.
It's an attempt to make London rather like Napoleon's Paris, really redevelop it on a huge scale by the Prince Regent's favourite architect, John Nash.
So, Malcolm, are you proud of him?
Proud? I should say I am. I think that's the greatest thing he's ever done. Really wonderful.
Being reunited, I think it's fabulous.
Definitely.
It's
wonderful.
You've got yourself one hell of a building here, Barry. How did you come across it?
Looking at the buildings at risk register for Scotland.
I mean, are you trying to do it on the cheap or something? Is there something you're telling us?
No.
Seriously?
There's just so many people involved.
These people haven't even seen the bloody building, man. This is one of the most historic buildings in Scotland.
Once you understand why it's there, who built it, that can better inform your decision about what you can do with it.
Dun, dun, dun.
That is brilliant.
That's my gentle giant waiting to be awoken.
We feel that the line needs to be drawn at the ones that we've still got left.
You know, you want somebody to rescue a building, but then you don't want them to be able to live in it properly.
I have to applaud Historic Scotland and English Heritage for their fastidious approach to the conservation of these magnificent buildings.
My wife and I are big fans of Jonathan Creek, and it was just bought on a whim.
I managed to get stabiliser condition enough that she was home for 4 days before she passed away.
This is my favourite room.
Oh my God! Oh my God! So the Prince of Wales actually stayed in this room.
I mean, you're talking millions. Millions.
God, that is beautiful, isn't it? Look at that.
I think we're up to about maybe 600 now.
600?
Individual enrichments.
Oh, my word.
This is why we fell in love with the place.
Now that is incredible.
It's not level, I'll eat this hat.
People who own the Grade 1 list of buildings are guardians of our heritage. You know, we put a lot of faith in these people.
It would take 10 years. I think I'm going to change it to 20 now.
Well, our friends say that the first party here will be my retirement party.
Mark tells me when he's bought it.
Right, afterwards.
Afterwards.
Once you get that thing about a property or anything, you really, really want it. It seems to take over and you sort of put all the problems with the property. Don't seem to matter.
I suppose at the minute that you're financing the entire thing out of your own pocket, there's no bank money.
I have a chest pain all weekend, but it's stressful. You don't paint it anyway.
Oh, what have you done? What have you done?
It's plastic in it.
Bloody plastic!
Get out of here.
I don't treat you any differently than I would treat any other owner of a listed building. I make everybody jump through the hoops, unfortunately.
For me, you've saved an important piece of history in this building. Yeah. And actually, you've created a fantastic building for you and your family for years to come. I think it's fantastic.
Well, thanks, George.
That's
well
lovely.
Done. Honestly, you should
You keep that safe, because I did it for you, babe.
Thanks. Yeah.